squad.
I can't recall an incident of racist chanting or racist abuse from crowds.
But tonight, the London programme revealed that racism is still rife on and off the pitch.
You'll never know what it feels like to be standing there and people can, opponents can say, or the crowd can stand up of a group of 50 people and shout, black this, black that.
I'd like to think that they're man enough and professional enough to let it rise above their head. They get paid good money.
You can't go and pay £12 to racially abuse someone. It's not a vending machine where you just pay money and you can just say what you want.
Meet a convicted racist who's free to go to the World Cup. Kevin Ryan is a keen Millwall fan, but he's banned from attending matches for 5 years for obscene racist chanting.
Initially, I denied saying anything, but then in the end, I thought there's no point in the court, so I put my hands up. They charged me, and that's when I got the ban.
Police had filmed Ryan using the worst racist language they'd ever heard. They refused to allow us to broadcast it because it was too offensive, but they gave us the transcript of part of what he'd said.
It's basically just words, but I use the wrong words, don't I? I would like to think that they'd take it as a pinch of salt as such. I've got black friends, so I haven't got a problem with it. They're calling each other niggers. But if a white man calls him a nigger, then he's being racist. I can't work it out.
Players we've spoken to said that people making comments like that have really scarred them.
I'd be very, very surprised at that. I think they're probably just... I can understand, yeah, that they'd be a little bit angry.
Ryan isn't only banned from Millwall games.
Any game that involves a Premier team or a Nationwide team or England games within England and Wales. By all accounts, I can go to Scotland, I can go to Northern Ireland if I wanted to watch football there. It's only England and Wales.
So could you go to France?
If I wanted to, yeah.
But it's not just individuals like Ryan that are the problem. Organised racist groups are still actively recruiting at international matches. Last month, we filmed National Front members handing out leaflets to England fans at Wembley. When they spotted our cameras, they soon disappeared, leaving only their leaflets behind. Racially motivated violence has traditionally been associated with football. These calling cards have been collected by undercover officers over 20 years. It seems like this that the police's football intelligence unit are trying to prevent at the World Cup. But it'll prove difficult to stop the troublemakers from crossing the channel. This week, the Home Secretary, Jack Straw, announced a partnership with the French, which will see English hooligans in breach of restriction orders being brought before French courts. But the London programme has discovered that this initiative will only apply to 65 hooligans. The vast majority of known offenders are subject to exclusion orders, which only ban them from games played in England.
Restriction orders have actually been in place since 1989, but have been sadly underused. Exclusion orders, however, are routinely given by magistrates, but we've said, well, hang on a minute, we've got good legislation here. This can actually stop these people travelling and causing problems abroad. Let's use them.
Kevin Ryan is just one of the fans that can take advantage of this loophole.
I made various, you know, racial statements, and I can't say whether I'd have gone any further or not. I mean, I can't answer that. I'd like to think I wouldn't.
There are another 339 fans just like Kevin Ryan, supporters who've been banned from domestic games for offences including racism, hooliganism and violence, but who are still quite free to cross the channel next week to follow England's fortunes in the World Cup. But these people are just the ones who've been caught. There are thousands more whose racist behaviour is ruining the British game, ruining it for their fellow fans as well as for the players on the pitch.
I don't pay, you know, like 19 quid a game to have a load of racists stood behind me calling people black bastards and packies and everything else.
You get people who chant racist abuse who sit there with no action taken whatsoever.
Once those people are 2,000 or 3,000 strong, it's almost impossible to stop them if they're determined to act.
Match day at Watford Football Club, and putting out the strips is a special moment for coach Luther Blissett. He's been in football for 23 years and was one of the first black players to win an England cap.
You wish you were still a player, because it's still the best part. When you arrive for a game and the kit's all ready, you just come and you put your bag down and you just sit and you relax maybe for a little while, and the game's on your mind then. It's your end, and you just really can't wait for 7:30 to come around so you can kick off.
When Blissett first started playing in the 70s, he was shocked by the reaction from the terraces.
Yet again in defence all over the place.
I really just couldn't believe the abuse you were getting from the crowd, you know. You know, all the like the monkey chants and bananas being slung on the pitch and one thing. I'm just calling your names, and it does make you wonder why people have to do it. It has stuck with me, and that I've really gone through my career with pretty much that in mind.
That feeling is shared by most black players. Mark Bright has also endured racial prejudice.
It just makes you really want to do something back. It makes you sort of want to throw the ball, kick. And it was a young lad as well, and you look at them and they're effing blind. And if you say one word to them, if you say F off to them, if they report you, two people report you to the police will come and interview you.
If a black player, for instance, makes a mistake, you say, you black bastard. I don't think that's racism. When it's said like that, I think it's just a term of endearment, really.
Many black players are told by their clubs to ignore racial insults. That was the advice Mark Bright got from his manager when playing for Leicester City.
And I said to him, you'll never know what it feels like to be standing there and opponents can say, or the crowd can stand up, a group of 50 people, and shout black this, black that, and make monkey chants at you, and you have to just stand there and look at them and not say nothing. If you say something, they can report you. If you make a gesture with your fingers, you have to apologise. So I said, you never know what that feels like to have to do it. And he said, it's the only way to deal with it.
Eric Cantona knows how it feels, but he couldn't keep his cool in the way that black players had been doing for years. In 1995, he retaliated against a fan who racially abused him.
I think if that had been a black person, I think the black person may have been hung, drawn and quartered. Maybe if he wasn't, if it had been a well-known black person, maybe not. But certainly your average first division, second division or third division player, I think would probably never have played the game again.
Instead, after being banned for the rest of the season, Cantona's career continued. Aware of these problems, the new Labour government decided to prioritise racism in football. Sports Minister Tony Banks set up a task force headed by David Mellor. In March this year, the task force report was published, suggesting 46 recommendations to rid the game of racism. David Mellor is optimistic about its chances of success.
I mean, it's not rocket science. There's no reason why they shouldn't get on with it quite quickly. I should be very disappointed if by the autumn we don't have a very clear idea of where we're going.
This is the task force report. 53 pages long. It's a comprehensive approach to tackling the problem of racism in football. It recommends banning of racist behaviour both on and off the pitch, encouraging clubs to attract more black supporters from their local communities, and it wants to see it made obligatory for all employees of football clubs, from the ground staff up to the boardroom, to sign an anti-racist declaration. But tonight, the London programme can reveal that key elements of this report may never be implemented. Head of the Football Association, Graham Kelly, thinks many of the problems have gone away.
Are you worried that there is still a high level of racist activity amongst spectators?
No.
And the government still hasn't set a timetable to implement the recommendations of the report.
You asked me a specific question, have I got a detailed timetable now? And the answer to that question, honestly, is no.
The authorities would rather concentrate on improvements already made.
I think we've done a lot to eliminate the worst excesses of racism within the main professional clubs. Well, you can always cite a football club, you know, where things haven't improved. But I'm telling you where, in one club that was particularly bad, Chelsea, where it has dramatically improved.
While even black players say the Premiership isn't as bad as it was, the same can't be said for lower divisions, where most footballers earn a living.
It's come to a point now where we can no longer ignore it and we've got to do something about it.
You can go to certain games where you almost feel like you, if you close your eyes, you can be back in the 70s.
Brighton player Andy Ansah has been on the receiving end of racial abuse throughout this season.
There are certain games, especially as we travel up north, I wouldn't let my family come to because of the abuse. And they're not there to tolerate that sort of thing, sitting in a crowd where they're in a position of without any strength whatsoever. I wouldn't want them to go through it. We went to Rotherham, there was three black players playing for Brighton at the time, and as we went up for the, out for the warm-up, there was a section of, I'd say, about 20 or 30, there was only young kids under the age of 10 that were just racially abusing us, swearing like black this, black bastard, fucking black cunt, and things like that. Fathers and kids, everyone, they were just, everything was black this, everything was referred to colour. Nigger this, black that, and there was kids sitting on their father's shoulders racially abusing us.
There ain't no black in the Union Jack and stuff like that. I mean, I know I've got friends who do that. I won't join in with them, but you, I mean, if you tell them to, you know, be quiet, then you're not gonna, they're not gonna be too, you know, because they're your friends, you don't really want to, you know, interrupt them or anything.
Well, they feel as though if I pay average 10, 12 pounds to get into a game, I should be free to say what I want and do what I want, which is something we need to address and to make clear that you can't go and pay 12 pounds to racially abuse someone. It's not a vending machine where you just pay money and you can just say what you want. It doesn't work like that.
But that's exactly what happened to Ansah at Hereford last November. It was the first round of the FA Cup.
There was one voice I could keep hearing, and it was about six or seven rows back, so I could just keep hearing black this and black that. And then it got closer and closer. This fellow had made his way down to the front, called me a black bastard, a nigger, telling me to fuck off back home, and things like that. So I carried on warming up, and at this I came back again, and he stood there and started to do the hand finger across the throat, as if to say he was going to slice my throat. He was going to cut me across my throat.
Ansah alerted a police officer and the man was arrested.
I was pleased at that, but I still got to pose a question that if it wasn't such a big game, being the first round of the FA Cup and having such high policing at the ground, this fella would have got away with that and nothing would have been done because it would have been only stewards around him.
At lower league matches, without the money that comes from television rights, police presence is restricted by cost and stewards are used for security.
To be fair, a steward is not in a position whereby he can make a citizen's arrest. He's going to jump into where there's 1,000 supporters and pick out one and say, I'm arresting you for racially abusing someone.
The task force identified this problem and recommended that football's supreme body, the Football Association, should ensure that stewards are trained to deal with racist incidents. I went to ask Graham Kelly, chief executive of the FA, how he planned to implement this.
From the steward's point of view at a club match, what should he or she expect to be told by the FA that they should do if they hear somebody shouting racist abuse?
Racist intimidation is obnoxious and should be dealt with very quickly by anybody in a football ground.
How?
Well, that's a matter for the law and order procedures for the rules of the ground.
What we're talking about is how this is enforced, and
it's got to be enforced.
But the question is how that is.
It's got to be enforced somehow. I don't know how, but it's got to be enforced.
One player who eventually quit the game because of racism was Richie Moran. But even earlier in his career, he felt he was treated differently from other players, including at Birmingham City, where Lou Macari was manager.
Called me into his office and asked me why I had dreadlocks. Apart from the fact I was quite shocked at the question, I explained it was an affirmation of my African heritage, which was met with derision. He then told me that I had to get my hair cut off because it wasn't appropriate for a professional footballer.
Moran moved on and played for other clubs. But throughout the rest of his career, he found it very difficult to deal with the attitudes of other players.
The stock in trade phrases, he doesn't mean it, he's only joking. Just keep your mouth shut and take the money. I heard this from black and white players now. I feel the need, unfortunately, to be able to look at myself in the mirror every morning, which isn't a pretty sight entirely, but somebody's got to do it. But so I just don't see that I have to accept stuff like that.
The final straw for Moran came on a pre-season training session at Torquay.
Got to the end of training and the assistant manager at the time said, right, we'll have a five-a-side, we'll have the white boys over here and the coons over here. And I'm like, sorry? And he's like, you know, the white boys over here, niggers over here. And I'm like, you do know what my name is, don't you? My name's Richie. If you don't want to use my name, then don't speak to me. And I was henceforth on the train home very shortly afterwards.
Moran left professional football.
It's had an enormous impact on my life. It's had a great impact on my bank balance, for a start. It has cost me, effectively, a career in football, and I think this message needs to be heard.
Moran feels it needs to be heard by those who run football in England, the FA.
There's still so much institutional racism. You have an example a couple of years ago, Lennart Johansson, who was the president of UEFA, made some disgraceful racist comments in South Africa about blackies, etc. And I mean, if you have somebody in the upper echelons at a game like this being allowed to actually get away with making comments like this, is it any wonder that it filters down through the management system?
Is the FA, as a member of UEFA, comfortable with a president who, it is reported, says things like it was full of blackies and it was getting effing dark when they were all sitting together?
Well, the FA has had a lot of support from Lennart Johansson over the years. He, I think, admits that he made a mistake in attempting to make a joke. I don't know whether it was a joke or what it was.
Pretty crap joke, wasn't it?
It's not for me to say.
The makeup of the FA I would describe as your archetypal white male institution, and the confidence I have in them is virtually zero.
In part two, the black football team, which was suspended from the league after one of its players was stabbed with a machete.
I saw a young man waving a long blade, and he was saying, come on you niggas if you want some more.
There's 53 Rosalie Avenue, Daventry, Hilltop, Hillrise, Mill Green, Aberdeen, Dunroman, Home Sweet Home, in Broadstairs, Smallstairs, Lurches in Aberdare, Treetop, Seaview, Shaynew, 22, Mews in Catford, Bungalows in Walthamstow.
Have a nice view,
Leslie
Avenue, number 8,
Harrogate,
patio, garden gate,
thatch
near, hatch and coat, back and crouch, and
frame
window frame.
Dunroman again,
two up,
two down,
anywhere, any town, centers in suburbia, couldn't be suburbia.
Front door, back door, black door, green house, new house, happy home in High Street,
another Dunroman.
Whoever you are, whenever you want to buy a home, it pays to decide nationwide.
Thank you.
old-fashioned and racist attitudes still exist within the boardrooms of football. Despite the number of black players, there are no black managers today.
You do think, is there something else? I mean, that is something that ultimately you probably will end up thinking about if you keep getting the door shut in your face all the time.
You know certain people who are comfortable in your company, certain people who would rather you not be there. And they're still around.
One place Kamara didn't feel welcome was at Port Vale this season. He was managing Bradford City.
As we're walking off at half-time, one of the fans ran down from the terraces and once again started abusing me, at black souls, or this and that and the other. I immediately said to the steward, you know, just make sure that this supporter is thrown out the ground. Well, the steward wasn't interested in this. He just wanted to push me down into the tunnel and get me out of the way. Just after half-time, the Port Vale chairman allowed the supporter back into the ground, claiming it was mistaken identity, that they'd thrown the wrong person out.
Kamara wrote to the club to complain. Port Vale replied to the FA.
I went berserk when I saw the letter that the Port Vale secretary had sent to the Football Association. I couldn't believe it, honestly. And I got on to him and I absolutely went bananas. And he said, look, I'm sorry about this, but maybe I've got the wrong end of the stick and I will send you an apology. He never did. He came up to me when I played down there with Stoke this year and said, mumbled a few things. And I said, well, I'm still waiting for that apology. So you've got it now. And that was it, basically.
In the letter, it implies that Kamara incited the trouble, something he categorically denies.
Port Vale would rather have the fan paying his money every week, knowing that he's going to be there every week, rather than Chris Kamara coming once or twice a season to visit their football ground, which obviously stinks, but it's the way of the world.
In a statement, Port Vale stood by its decision to allow the fan back in and refuted allegations that the club condoned racist behaviour.
The task force report is full of fine words and good intentions, but it suffers from one crucial defect. It has no clout. This means that it's being left up to the FA and the club themselves to adopt an anti-racist strategy. But critics believe that unless this is backed by government legislation, then it amounts to nothing more than hot air.
We are essentially going to rely on people's goodwill and determination to drive racism out, and it's going to be done through voluntarism rather than coercion.
One would look to the government to say to the FA, what is your implementation plan for the recommendations that affect the FA?
When do you think that will happen?
Well, I can't give sooner rather than later. I mean, I haven't got a detailed timetable on how all these things are going to be implemented.
The changes that need to be made are not just at the professional end of the game. Football at park level has some of the worst problems. The Football Association governs the game, but it's a duty that seems sadly neglected. Across London, over 2,000 teams compete in 261 leagues. For some black players, the football pitch has become a battlefield. Meet Barry FC, an all-Asian team getting ready for a Sunday match.
All the boys get together, we enjoy ourselves. It's like a little community where we gather in and have a little chat here and there, and then we just go and play football.
Last season, Barry FC joined the South Essex League. The team was subjected to a barrage of racial abuse from their predominantly white opponents.
When we start playing the top teams, when we start beating them, scoring goals, they didn't like it, they just spit at us, they just spit at us. Racial comments, like, you're packy, what are you doing here?
Many of Barry's players became disillusioned.
It hurts, it does hurt. And you
do want to talk about it, but you say on the pitch that you've got to take it.
Barry's most terrifying ordeal last season began before the match had even started.
We're just approaching the pitch, all of us together, and the first remark that we heard after some meeting dietary remarks was loudly, if these Pakis win, let's see how they get out alive.
Yunus, at one stage, was very badly tackled. He got kicked as well. He had a nosebleed and he had a really bad cut over his eye. And he's there on the floor and he's kneeling on the floor, and one of their players says to him, why are you praying to your God now, you Paki? He's not going to help you now.
Once the second half started, people got kicked around, punched, elbowed, abused. Pakis, what are you doing here on a Sunday? And got corner shops to run. It got to a stage when we all got together and we said, let's abandon the game. But the referee didn't take no action at all.
After the match, a fight broke out between the two teams. At a later disciplinary hearing, Barry FC was fined for bringing the game into disrepute. They decided to leave the league as they no longer felt welcome.
Only we know what went on that day. We know how we were treated. We know the mistreatment that we received since then. And yet, we're the ones who have been victimized and portrayed as being the violators.
It's a common story. 5 miles away, a black church-based team, the Islanders, are having an evening training session.
I love the sport. I think football is the most passionate sport. I mean, if football was a woman, I'd marry her because I like the game so much.
What I really like about football, particularly on a Sunday, it's not only the getting up, but it's the sweat. It's that smell of deep heat. My time is spent extremely joyfully kicking that ball.
But for now, Tony's game is limited to training sessions because the team has been suspended from the Corinthian League in East London. Like Barry FC, the problems began with a tirade of racial abuse.
It has come part and part of the game, unfortunately. You do try to just wave it off, but there are times when it does get a little personal. Coon and nigger and stuff like that, that you know, is nothing to me. That means nothing to me at all.
But in March, events took a violent turn.
We played this team before and it was a good, strong match, so we were actually looking forward to a return. There had been a lot of talk insinuating colour. Also, there'd been a lot of talk regarding nigger and so forth.
A decision went against a player and a fight broke out.
I was walking towards the fracas and I was caught at the side of my mouth, which I thought was a punch. And I went down, my head cleared, I got back up, and there was a lot of blood. There was some big gashing in my mouth. My face was aching. And I saw a young man about 10 yards away waving quite a long blade. And he was saying, come on, you niggers, if you want some more. In the changing room in the mirror, I'd taken a close look at my mouth and I could see there was a hole straight through the lower lip. And a friend of mine said, no, you got caught with a ring. But another teammate said to me, no, that doesn't look like a ring, Tone. That actually looks like a stab. When I did go down to the police station and I actually got to see the knife for myself, it was a 14-inch blade, which kind of frightens me.
Both teams have been banned from the league, despite the evidence of the referee's report, which completely exonerates the Islanders.
For the aggression that we had received on that day, we should not have been banned from the league. We should have been able to finish our 4 or 5 matches comfortably.
The team is due for a disciplinary hearing for bringing the game into disrepute at the London FA, part of the Football Association. But they still haven't got a date.
I don't believe the FA have made a priority over this case at all. I think they may see this just as an isolated case and hoping that nothing will come of it, that it won't develop out, you know, and that it may never happen again.
The task force report recommends strong action to be taken against racists at park level. But when and how is this going to happen?
I don't want to mislead people. I mean, it's no good me saying it's by the 31st of March
and 1999, all of these things will be in place. I can't, it's unrealistic.
We asked Graham Kelly what he could do as head of the FA.
In this case, it's a case of a game, a team called Ireland. Is it something that you would look into?
Well, I can't give that commitment because I don't know where that particular incident is at within the FA procedures.
While the team awaits the FA's decision, Tony's unsure about whether to continue playing.
It's really made me question as to whether I will return to the pitch, to a game I've really enjoyed. Well, I'd love to run and pick that up. In my heart, I'm hoping that it won't be the last game, but my instincts are telling me maybe it's time to hang up the boots.
Back in Forest Gate, Barry FC have joined a new league. Things have improved a bit, although refereeing is still an issue.
One of our players got sent off a lot later, near the end of the game, and he said to him, "That's it, you're a cheating packy." Shows him the red card and sends him off. When you get an official doing that, it really does hammer it into you that, well, what are you up against here?
Mellor's task force recommends setting targets for more black and Asian referees.
I was rather impressed with the fact that, for instance, the chief executive of the FA, the chief executive of the Premiership, who are both on the task force, were quite happy to sign up to this and to endorse its recommendations.
Do you agree with the task force proposal that the FA should set targets for the numbers of black and Asian coaches and referees?
I don't think I necessarily agree with setting targets. Certainly our technical people aren't keen to set targets. But
do you then not accept that task force's own argument, which the FA signed, that without targets nothing will ever happen?
No, the FA didn't sign it.
Or let me put it another way. You clearly don't accept the task force's argument that without targets nothing's ever going to happen.
I don't think nothing will ever happen without targets. Things are happening.
So you essentially reject this idea at all?
Yes.
Completely?
Yeah.
It's little wonder that no Asian player has ever made it into the professional game. At the Norman Chester Institute for Football Research in Leicester, John Williams thinks it's all about prejudice.
The stereotype which worked against black players coming through, that is, that they're not bright enough, they're not intellectual, they're all body and then they're no brains. The reverse of the stereotype works against Asians. You know, they're all brains, they're not committed enough, they don't focus enough, they've got other things they want to do. So I think now the major barrier is about the way in which clubs see young Asians. They always feel that they're approaching everybody in the same way. What they don't do is examine the channels through which they go and try and recruit.
Here in Leicester, that's exactly what they're trying to do. Rashid Mama is both a scout for Leicester City Football Club and a coach for young Asian players.
No plan, if you can call loud enough. Go on, then. Good. How did that feel? All right, keep, well done. Go on, keep going.
There's none Asian football player, so we're acting like role models, and that makes it easier for them. They feel more confident because we do understand the cultures as well.
Good, well done.
There's a structure here which allows Asian children to progress from grassroots level through the School of Excellence to the club.
I try to teach them whatever I can, coaching wise, working on the technique, at the same time giving them advice and helping the parents as well. And if I see a talented kid, obviously I take him to School of Excellence so he doesn't feel out of place.
Leicester's proud of its scheme, but it's a different story for London's Asians.
I suspect in some parts of the country, perhaps in parts of London, certainly in parts of the north where there are large Asian populations, I suspect it's much less well advanced and there's still a lot of work to be done.
With agents, I suppose they're more their national game would more be cricket or things like that, whereas ours is football.
In part three, why the black community would rather support the reggae boys. and how London's worst club is turning itself round and closing in on the racists.
At the end of the day, I'm calling him the Black Bastard. I don't even know the fellow. He could be a nice bloke.
Looking and analysing, studying form and light. It says Turner had poor eyesight in later life. It must have driven him to distraction. My paintings are all about atmosphere, detail, texture, the little things that make up the whole image. It's all there, and all you have to do is to look. My eyesight's pretty important to me.
Nokia 5110 is the first mobile phone with covers you can change yourself in seconds. For freedom of expression, the Nokia 5110 with Nokia Express-On covers. Nokia, connecting people.
The Comet summer sale has now kicked off with amazing saves. Find them in the Comet price index in the papers this Saturday. Get it right. Come to the Comet sale.
You never know when luck will strike. This Saturday, you could celebrate the luckiest night of your life.
It's you.
Is there anything more natural than fresh air? Without it, you could feel uncomfortable. It's the same with your pant liner. It'll protect you all right, but what if air can't get through? Carefree breathable pant liners have no plastic backing. Instead, unique micropores let air circulate freely. All the protection you need, all the freshness you could ask for. Naturally breathable is carefree breathable.
My buddies and me, you're getting real well known. Yeah, the bad guys know us and they leave us alone. I get around.
With a BT charge card, calls are charged to your phone bill. All our usual discounts apply, saving you up to 35% on the calls you make with it while you're out and about.
Only 1% of fans who attend Premier League matches is black. The task force hopes to change this, but there's a big problem. Although many black people love the game, they still don't feel welcome. Chad, aged 9, has supported Arsenal since he was 3, but he's never been to Highbury. His dad won't allow it.
Generally, most games are associated with louts, who sort of get drunk, abusive, and chant racist things at you at the end of the game or during the game. So. I don't think, really think it's a very safe environment for a young child or for your wife, as a matter of fact.
Today, they are going to watch football. Errol and 30 friends are off to see Jamaica play Manchester City. And Chad's coming too. This is one match where Errol feels the family will be safe, unlike the bus driver who's concerned about trouble.
In Manchester?
Yeah. They come and...
No, they're not going to trouble. It's Jamaican fans.
You're playing with England, aren't you?
No, we're playing Manchester City, yeah. The Jamaica team, yeah. But they're not going to do anything.
Okay, dear Lord, we are about to embark on this our journey. We ask you that you guide the driver, guide the team, give them the courage and the grace that they might win. We do need the win. This we pray in your name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Time to catch up on football gossip.
Four cops go to France.
12.5 million, you know. 2.5 million a season.
Yeah, you didn't hear.
The reason why I'm going to this match all the way, because it's my home team, right? And I want to be there to support my team.
The match has been promoted to London's black community by Winston Clark. He thinks one reason that black people don't go to football is because it isn't marketed properly.
Football is a commodity. It's a product that needs to be sold. It is sold, but it's not sold to the black community. The game was, if you like, brought about by white people in England. And if you want other people to be or to feel as though they're part and parcel of that invitation, you need to invite people.
You know what I mean? Stick some of them flyers inside the place. Yeah.
So Winston's marketing campaign is a series of invitations for the black community.
Flyers for you and everything. Jamaica, Man City, down right there.
Well, we're marketing the game through all the regular outlets, places like record shops, food outlets, clothing outlets. A lot of black people go to. We do a lot of leafleting, and we use community radio stations. And obviously the word of mouth issue works very well.
Jamaica! Yeah.
A lot of coloured people, they're more into athletics and not into football so much. Very fit people. And I feel they do their own thing.
It seems like there should be a simple answer. Market the game to the black communities, make them feel welcome by not tolerating racist behaviour, and then they'll come to the matches. Some clubs are doing just that, and they've already seen an upturn in the number of black fans attending matches. But some seem keener to continue with the status quo, and not do anything that might alienate existing fans. Elland Road, Leeds, and the New Den, Millwall. Two clubs with perhaps the worst reputation in the country for racism and violence. Millwall's fans have always been in the spotlight.
And Millwall fans on the pitch having a go at Collymore. He should get off very quickly. That's not doing Millwall any favours.
But the two clubs have a very different approach to dealing with racism. We found that while Millwall is doing all it can to tackle the problem, Leeds seems to have a more low-key approach. An ordinary group of fans settled down for a few pints before a Leeds match. The fans love the club, but they don't love the way it's being run. And what they object to most is what they see as the club's failure to deal with groups of hardcore racists.
I don't pay, you know, like 19 quid a game to have a load of racist of the army calling people black bastards and packies and everything else.
When Leeds played Leicester at home this season, they were out in force.
A group of people who were sit lower down in the stand where I sit, in the north stand, maybe about 30, 40 people started singing, "You're just a town full of packies."
I happened to have an Asian friend sat next to me at the match, and it made it all the more galling, so I immediately stood up and I said, "We might be losing, but we don't need that sort of language or activity at Leeds United."
The fans began to compare notes over the internet to try and identify the racists.
I wrote a short note saying, "Yes, I heard it." And then a number of people on reading that said, "Well, I was there, I saw what happened, or I heard what happened. I'm going to complain to the club in writing about it."
And they did, in numbers. Bukok wrote to the chairman.
I wrote to him and I said that I was very unhappy about what I'd seen, and that I understood that the rules of the club were such that if people were involved in this activity, not only would they be ejected from the ground, but they would be banned from all future matches.
Well, in my email to him, we told him that we'd identify these people, we knew who they were. We didn't know who started the chant, we knew people who joined in with it. At the end of the day, you know, by association, that's as bad in my eyes.
I got no reply. Nothing happened.
Meanwhile, Chairman Peter Risdale told the local paper he hadn't received any complaints.
The club must know where people sit in that area. It's an area where people have season tickets.
The fans think it's all down to money.
I think if they thought that they could make money out of donkey racing, they'd change the ground into a donkey racing thing. It's all to do with money. They're running it as a business.
Back in London, police at Millwall are preparing for the last match of the season. Working with the club, they play a crucial role in dealing with racism. The first stage is admitting there's a problem.
We have to accept that there is racism. If you don't accept that, as some clubs don't, then you're never going to quash it.
Before you go out on duty, please make sure you've got one of these. It gives you location, your nearest emergency phones.
Stewards are briefed to look out for racism.
Should you get any problems from the public, obscene chanting, racial abuse or anything of that nature, please bring it to the attention of your supervisor as soon as possible and we'll get it dealt with. They're arrestable offences and ejectable, so please bring that to our attention.
The game kicks off and police are on the lookout for racists. With the use of CCTV, they can quickly spot troublemakers. In this case, it's drunks.
Can we photograph him?
Make it sooner rather than late.
It's got to be quick.
The information was that they had concealed weapons. We don't want them outside without them being searched.
But today, police are also taking the first steps to identify a group of racists after a complaint from a fan.
We concentrate stewarding in that particular area. We concentrate our CCTV cameras to identify who that person is. Now, what we have done today is to identify by photograph those fans who we think is responsible. We've got no direct evidence. Our next step is to see the complainant to say, are these the people? And then we can take some action against them.
This police footage shows a fan caught by the cameras earlier this year. He was arrested and charged under the Football Offences Act for indecent chanting. In the same way, last year, Kevin Ryan was caught and prosecuted.
I was sitting right at the back and a couple of fellas came up and said, Kevin, come here. Basically, I didn't know what they wanted while they was pulling me out. And I come to the aisle to go down with them, and he said, you know why you're arrested, don't you? And I said, no. He said, for making racial chants.
Ryan is full of remorse now and claims he's been made an example of by Millwall's new chairman.
I've watched more Millwall games than he's probably had at dinners. So how he can, you know, condemn me, he doesn't even know me, he's never met me, he's never spoken to me. So how he can class me as, you know, as a racist fuck with beyond me, I made racist comments, yeah. But that doesn't automatically make you a racist.
Ryan says that he can control himself in future.
Whoa! I've only served a year in the band. I'm suffering, you know, suffering in that sense that I can't go to games. And I know one city move a game and I'll get a life ban. So I'll bite my tongue and sit on my hands.
But Millwall is not prepared to take the risk. The club told us that it will never allow him back into the ground.
What we are now is responding to what the genuine fans want, is that they don't want this level of abuse, they don't want this level of indecent chanting, and they are pointing out by letter, by telephone, and coming to see us to tell us where it is happening. And with our partners in the police service, we are actually taking positive action against the complaints that are made.
It's exactly the kind of action that Leeds fans are after. But the return match between Leeds United and Leicester was even worse. Leicester fans, Jeff Davison and Kevin Sheriff, were amazed at what happened.
What particularly upset me about it was the number involved here. You know, I mean, there has been occasions when a section of away supporters at Leicester have started some kind of racist chanting. But this, to hear it from where I was, at the volume I heard it, would have to mean that 400 or 500 Leeds fans were actually singing this.
The network of Leeds fans started working again, and once more letters were written to the club.
I then wrote again to Peter Risdale and said, look, I've written to you about this once already and you ignored me. It's happening again. I want to know what the club are doing about it.
I don't understand it. I mean, it's a pretty simple thing to do. Check, you know, a block of seats of about 200 seats, look at all the names, see where all the area, you know, look at the postcodes, just do a postcode search, see where they're all coming from, see how many of them are going to away matches, see which games get trouble at. It doesn't take a genius to work it out, and, you know, they've just not done anything about it.
So we asked Leeds if they'd give us an interview to discuss the club's anti-racist policy. But they declined, saying they were too busy.
I think the club talk's a good argument. I think the club itself, though, I mean, I think you have to look at actions. Actions speak louder than words in my eyes. And those people are still there. They were there last Saturday, you know, when we went to the game. They'll be there tomorrow.
We have written to them on two occasions, talking about the problem, wanting them to address the problem that they have. And it's significant when it happens, when racist abuse and chanting happens at a Premier League club. Leeds have responded slowly, I think is the best way of describing it.
We asked the Football Association whether they were concerned about it.
Doesn't it suggest that you've got to do more? Because you go to a Leeds-Leicester match, and what you hear is Leeds fans, you know, when they're losing, shouting racist abuse, you know, your town is full of fatties. That has got to stop.
Well, it is stopping. I mean,
it's still happening.
No, I'm sorry, it is stopping. What you saw was a very swift and a very professional response from Leeds.
Well, Leeds supporters say that actually the club isn't doing very much. Then, in fact, all of the actions having to be led by the supporters rather than by the club.
Well, I would hope that everybody in the game knows that that sort of thing is not acceptable and is a very much an isolated example of something which is no longer tolerated in English football.
Well, the point is, it's not stopping. That's the problem,
it
isn't
it? It is stopping.
The government maintains it can rely on the clubs and the FA to sort out the problem themselves.
You simply don't seem to accept that there is something called good faith, good intentions, and that they can work. I mean, if you're not going to be convinced, there's nothing I can do to actually convince you.
The question remains whether good intentions are enough.
It is a fact that there are no minority members of the FA Council.
Yes.
Does that distress you?
It doesn't distress me. I think it's a feature of football administration.
The task force is pretty clear, though. It says that the FA should take steps towards ensuring that there are minority members of its ruling bodies. The council, of course, is at the centre of that.
Yes.
What steps can you envisage taking?
I can't envisage taking any steps to dictate to our member associations who they elect to represent them on the FA Council.
When would you anticipate seeing the first non-white member of the FA Council?
I don't know. Sooner rather than later.
Years? Decades?
I don't know. I honestly don't know.
Just depends what you define racism. If you mean like little comments like you black cunt and things like that, that don't mean nothing. It's just like off the top of your tongue, isn't it?
Meanwhile, Chad and Errol are enjoying the friendly atmosphere at Main Road, even if the game isn't up for much. Half time, and it's nil-nil.
I just think we need a goal. The atmosphere is nice, and that's the most important thing.
Man City are playing well, I must give it to him, but 3-0. Prediction, final prediction, 3-0.
3-0 City.
Not a chance to help.
Second
division. Second division.
That's all we've got to say to you.
Can you drink, Phil?
Definitely. Yeah.
Oh, no, the atmosphere is great. I just hope we can do this in France. It'll certainly help. We're going to be like Cameroon, but we're going to do better. We'll see you later.
So, how long will it be before multiracial scenes like this one are commonplace in the British game?
I'd like to say very soon. I think, in my heart, I'd really like to say very soon, but it's a progression thing. I think you can't teach an old dog new tricks.
Until then, thousands of black football fans will stay away.
You can go to any nightclub, and any good nightclub's got a great mix of black, white or ethnic people in it, and it's a great feel, it's a great vibe, as they say. And hopefully there'll be a day when, you know, the black and white faces will fill the stands and there won't be any trouble, but that hope, I don't know how long it will be.